Good morning. It's Wednesday, second day of summer. Always seems like it comes quick, the summer. I don't like to think about it, but now our days will start getting shorter starting today. Which I don't like that. I like the long days. I like it getting bright earlier in the morning. I like it staying dark or staying light a lot longer. In the evening, I hate in the winter when it's dark by 4:30. I don't like that at all. But good morning, Dennis and Deanna and Kathy. Tawn, glad you're on here. Hope you're feeling okay. Savannah, glad you're on here too. Hope things are going well for you and your little ones there. So, but glad you guys are on here today. Hope that this can be a help to all of you as we look at this. I read something and it does, I guess it does kind of go along with what sometimes we feel and think, and this was I'll just read it for you. How's that? All right. This was written by a Soviet dissident, Alexander Solzhenitsyn, something like that, but definitely has somewhat of my attitude. But it says, the most terrifying force of death comes from the hands of men who wanted to be left alone. They try so very hard to mind their own business and provide for themselves and those they love. They resist every impulse to fight back, knowing the forced and permanent change of life that will come from it. They know that the moment they fight back, their lives as they have lived them are over. The moment the men who wanted to be left alone are forced to fight back, it is a form of suicide. They're literally killing off who they used to be, which is why, when forced to take up violence, these men who wanted to be left alone fight with unholy vengeance against those who murdered their former lives. They fight with raw hate and a drive that cannot be fathomed by those who are merely play-acting at politics and terror. True terror will arrive at these people's door, and they will cry, scream, and beg for mercy, but it will fall upon the deaf ears of the men who just wanted to be left alone. Some things maybe I don't totally agree with. I don't know that it would be hatred that drives one to fight, but I think that idea of protecting your own family and protecting your way of life. In we have people who are obedient to the laws. We pay our taxes. We're patriotic. We support our military. We support our law enforcement. We try to make it a better community as we live in it, We do what we can to be good citizens in this country, and it just doesn't seem to be enough with these knotheads, and they just continue to push themselves further and further in running the country in a way that makes them really, it makes them a bunch of despots is what it makes them to be, and controlling all areas of our lives. And the greatest thing about this country has been our freedom, and to the freedom to worship as we want, to gather as we want that way, to support our families, to protect our families, to provide for our families, and to just live a life of freedom. And they are they as in the politicians, Republicans, independents, and Democrats, and seems to be led the way by the Democrats, but they are doing what they can to really to take away that happiness and to take away the freedom. And freedom is God-given. The freedom isn't man-given. And that's why there's such a struggle here. They want to take away your God-given rights. Well, there's going to be a fight for that. And there will come a day when all of Americans and most of those 80-some, 90 million gun owners, those are the ones that want to be left alone and to live their lives in freedom that this country has stood for over, you know, close to 250 years now, and leave us alone. And they do not want that. And they cannot seem to just be passive in this idea that people want to have freedom and to be left alone. And so they just keep pushing it and pushing it and pushing it. And one day the good people are going to be put into a corner, and it's not a corner that they want to be put in, but we, you know, it's that day that righteousness will stand up, because the politicians of today are not righteous. And it's a joke. It really is a joke. And this video will probably, with the new gun control laws that they have voted on yesterday, and will soon become law. This video will be one that will flag me, and they will determine, you know, all they're going to do with the gun control laws that they're passing has nothing to do with gun control. It doesn't. I mean, they're passing laws on the mental state of people, and it's these wackadoodles that are going to determine your mental state. Ones who can't decide whether you're a guy or a girl or a they or an it or you know, a dog or a cat, or they're the very ones going to be telling you whether you have the mental capacity to handle a firearm or not. I mean, it's crazy days, I'm telling you. And we need to it's just the opposite, probably what I just did, than what I got in my devotions this morning. But I don't know. I read Proverbs 17:22. So I'm going to start there, and so we can get back on track, okay? Because I don't want to send anybody over the cliff here, you know. Don't forget, I better tell you this before we get started. I won't be on here tomorrow. I'm headed this afternoon to the Western Slope, to the little town of Fruta, and there's a funeral there tomorrow for Pastor Davis. He was my pastor years ago. When I surrendered to full-time ministry, he was preaching a message, and I surrendered to the ministry under him, and he went to glory on Sunday, and they're having the funeral tomorrow. So I will not be on here tomorrow, but Lord willing, should be back on here to finish up on Friday. So, but pray for traveling safeties this afternoon. It's about a 5-hour drive, and so would appreciate that. But let's get into this, and just don't let the world rob you of your joy. I mean, these guys are, and I guess we cross those bridges when we cross them, you know, when the challenges come, where the challenge is made that we are not allowed to worship as God shows us, as we are not able to, they want to take away the rights of protecting our families and providing for our families as God has given us that right. I guess we'll deal with that when the time comes, you know, and we'll cross that bridge. And until then, we need to keep walking with the Lord. And even then, we walk with the Lord. We don't fight out of hatred. We don't hate these people. We hate what they stand for. But we continue to fight the spiritual war, and we keep telling people about Christ, and let's live for him. In Proverbs 17:22, it says, "A merry heart doeth good like a medicine, but a broken spirit drieth the bones." That's the thing that in all of these things, and you can't hide what they're doing. I mean, it can be upsetting to see what they're doing. But here's the thing, we can't live in that and dwell on that constantly, because what it's doing, it breaks the spirit and it dries the bones, right? And that's not at all what we want. We need a merry heart doeth good like a medicine. So let's give some thought then. What is a merry heart? Well, I'll show you what a merry heart is. I was reading in Luke this morning, and Luke 15, and this is what it says in verses 3 and 4. "And he spake this parable unto them, saying, What man of you having 100 sheep, if he lose any of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he found it?" And then, until he findeth it. And then it says in Luke 19:10, "For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost." You know what a merry heart is? A merry heart is the realization that Jesus Christ sought you out. And if you have humbled your heart and opened your heart to him and sought him for forgiveness with a repentant and humble heart and asked him to save you, that you have eternal life today. And oh, how thankful we can be for eternal life. How thankful we can be that we have a Savior who loves us, even in the midst of just, I don't know, crazy things that we do and bad choices that we make. And I mean, there's all kinds of things that we do that would, you know, cause people to turn their backs on us. And when we're a child of God, he never, ever will turn his back on us. And that's something to be joyful about. I mean, that's something that gives you a merry heart, to know that you are forgiven, to know that your sins have been taken away, that they're as far as the east is from the west, that he is there with you and says he'll never leave you nor forsake you, that he empowers you, that he has gifted you with abilities to serve him and walk with him, and he gives you discernment to know what's right and what's wrong. And it just goes on and on, the wonderful things that God gives to us, and let us remember those things and not forget that, and just don't let the world rob you of your joy. The news, what a joke the news is. The news gives you no good news anymore whatsoever. I mean, it just doesn't. And so there's no reason to watch it, because all it does is affect one's attitude. And so we don't want that, right? We want to celebrate and rejoice in what God is doing, even in the midst of some horrible, terrible things that are going on. I should have read also, I can't do it now because we are on here, and I can't pull it up and read it and do this. But I also got a text from a friend that they support a missionary that is in the Ukraine right now. And he's in one of the cities in the Ukraine where a lot of refugees have come in to that city in the Ukraine while all this fighting is going on. Well, these guys are going out and they're giving the gospel, and there are hundreds. This missionary, solid guy, said that there are hundreds of these Ukrainian refugees that are trusting Christ as their Savior, and they're giving testimony that they are rejoicing in the battle that's going on, because it moved them to a place where they heard the gospel and trusted Christ as their Savior, and they rejoice in that. I mean, how amazing is that, to think that God would take a war that is an awful thing, and in that war is bringing honor and glory to himself. That's our Lord. That's what he does. And can make something bad and use it for good and bring honor and glory to himself. And so we never lose hope. We never quit praying. We never quit walking with the Lord. We want to share the gospel with whoever that comes our way. And all of these characters that are vying for this control and thinking that controlling of others is going to bring them happiness, they're just so deluded in their thinking and delusional in their thinking to think that that's going to bring them happiness. It isn't going to do that at all. It's just going to bring judgment upon their heads. And then here, I want to read Psalm 140. Here's a daily reminder to all of us, okay? And David writes this. He says, "Deliver me, O Lord, from the evil man. Preserve me from the violent man, which imagine mischiefs in their heart. Continually are they gathered together for war. They have sharpened their tongues like a serpent. Adder's poison is under their lips, Selah. Keep me, O Lord, from the hands of the wicked. Preserve me from the violent man who have purposed to overthrow my goings." Is that a prayer that we can pray? Absolutely. "Keep me, O Lord, from the hands of the wicked. Preserve me from the violent man who have purposed to overthrow my goings." Boy, is that powerful for us today too. "The proud have hid a snare for me and cords. They have spread a net by the wayside. They have set gins for me. I said unto the Lord, Thou art my God. Hear the voice of my supplications, O Lord. O God, the Lord, the strength of my salvation, Thou hast covered my head in the day of battle. Grant not, O Lord, the desires of the wicked. Further not his wicked device, lest they exalt themselves." Why can't we pray that? I mean, what's wrong with praying verses out of the Bible and praying the same thing that King David prayed? And here, "Grant not, O Lord, the desires of the wicked. Further not his wicked device, lest they exalt themselves." Lord, please stop. Stop this craziness that's going on in our country. Stop this craziness that's going on in our world. And think about it. I mean, think about, we look at these crazy things that's going on and some would say that we're losing, but isn't it going to be amazing if the Supreme Court comes out and rules against Roe versus Wade right in the middle of Biden's presidency? I mean, we have Biden, who is definitely pro-choice, pro-murder, I should say. We have the Democrats who control the House and the Senate, and they're pro-murder. And then they lose that very battle right in front of them with the Roe versus Wade, that golden calf that they worship and have worshiped since, what, 1971 or whatever it was. And here we see that God is stopping those things. I mean, and I know that Roe versus Wade doesn't stop the murder of the babies, but hey, it's a battle that we need to win. I mean, God's in this. And so here we need to continue to pray that, "Grant not, O Lord, the desires of the wicked. Further not his wicked device, lest they exalt themselves." Lord, humble these people, bring them to their knees. And honestly, we need to be brought to our knees probably too. And let us walk humbly with God. Let burning coals fall upon them. Let them be cast into the fire, into deep pits, that they rise not up again. Let not an evil speaker be established in the earth. Evil shall hunt the violent man to overthrow him. I know that the Lord will maintain the cause of the afflicted and the right of the poor. Surely the righteous shall give thanks unto thy name. The upright shall dwell in thy presence. Boy, that was needed today. I needed to hear that today. I mean, I read some of the things that these characters, these politicians who are supposed to be representing us, and the only thing they represent are themselves. And their only desire is to be reelected so that they can continue to feed their gluttony of money and power and the lewd living that they are representing up there in DC or in Denver and wherever. And how careful we need to be. And let us make sure that we walk humbly. And as we walk humbly, you know what God does? When we walk humbly with Him, God shows mercy to us. He gives us grace in our lives and He uses us. And in doing so, He brings honor and glory to Himself. And that's what we want. We want God to be glorified. We want Him to be on the throne. We want Him to be the one that leads us and guides us. And we want to represent Him well. And then in Acts 14, in Acts 14 and verse 15, I'll end with this, talking about walking humbly, okay? And we know that Paul has come into, I think they came into Lystra make sure it's Lystra, yes. And so they come in there and they start preaching and Paul heals this man that was lame, right? And so all of a sudden they all start worshiping him and calling him a god. And it tells us in verse 15, and saying, sirs, so he runs into the crowd who are getting ready to make sacrifices to Paul and the men that are with him and Barnabas, right? They're calling Paul and Barnabas gods. And they ran into the midst of them and said, saying, sirs, why do you do these things? We also are men of like passions with you and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities unto the living God, which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein. And then it says, and with these sayings, scarce restrained they the people that they had not done sacrifice unto them. And you know what I think? I think sometimes that we have guys today that have become these rock star preachers and instead of running into the midst of the crowd and telling them, hey, don't you be worshiping me. You need to worship the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And you need to be worshiping God Almighty. And instead they're taking that glory for themselves. And we've lost the power of the churches today because God isn't going to share His glory with anyone. And here we see that Paul walked humbly with God, and through that, God used him greatly. Now, doesn't mean things were easy, because you get to the next verse and it says that they drug him out on the street and they stoned Paul, drew him out of the city, supposing he'd been dead. And doesn't mean it's going to be easy. You know, this world is not our friend. This world needs to understand that they need to repent and they need to trust in the saving sacrifice of Jesus Christ. And we need to be men and women of character to love them enough to tell them that. And those that are wicked and that have given their hearts over to the devil and have a reprobate mind, then God deals with them, and pray that God does deal with them. Lord, do with them. If they want to live without you and without acknowledging you in any way, then give them that for eternity. And they will. And they'll suffer the consequences of their horrible choices that they're making. But doesn't, you know, what do? Hey, we rejoice in the salvation God's given us. We rejoice in His power on our lives. We rejoice in the joy that He places in us, even in the midst of chaos. God uses us and we can truly be satisfied and content with where God has us. So that's the joy of the day, right? So let's go out, let's live for the Lord. And if your church has a midweek service, you know what? Be there tonight and pray with other believers and be involved in the Bible study and whatever they do, and let's tell people about Jesus this week, and let's encourage believers to walk with Him. So God bless you guys and have a great day.